I welcome everybody very much to this virtual seminar. We are talking about the question whether green growth is possible and how to achieve it. This is a joint event, a joint virtual event of Bertelsmann Stiftung's Europe program, as well as the economics program. And we're also very happy to partner up with the ZOE Institute for Future-fit Economies. My name is Katharina Gnad. I work at Bertelsmann Stiftung, and I have the pleasure to moderate this panel. We set off with a not so easy topic and a not so easy question, namely the question or the debate whether our existing economic model is fit for purpose to achieve a net zero and a green economy in the short and medium term. And I'm very happy to be joined by Alessio, Terzi and Jonathan Barth. Alessio has written a book which is called Growth for Good, Reshaping Capitalism to Save Humanity from Climate Catastrophe. No smaller than that. If Alessio is not writing a book, then he's working as an economist at the European Commission and he teaches at Sciences Po in Lille. Also with us, and I'm very happy that we do this event together, is Jonathan Barth. He's a policy director of the ZOE Institute, and he's an expert on the economics of the green transition. We have an hour together, and you can all get ready at your screens to formulate some questions already, or there might be questions arising in the next couple of minutes, because we will have a conversation that will be started off by Alessio. He will present some of the ideas and probably some of the arguments why he believes green growth is possible. And we will have Jonathan reply to Alessio, and that's sort of kicking off the discussion also about the question of how we can achieve it. Where are the commonalities in our views, our perspectives, and where we might also have differences on the path towards a green or a net zero economy. And then we will bring in the audience. There's a button at the end, at the bottom of your screen where you can place some questions, and I will read them out and we will take it from there. But we start with Alessio, and I'm very happy that you're with us today. Alessio, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Katharina. Thanks to Bertelsmann for hosting this discussion, for creating this this event, to ZOE and to the ZOE Institute for co-hosting, to Jonathan for taking the time, and of course to the audience for taking the time as well to discuss about this this important topic. I will divide. I will give some. Perhaps introductory remarks is a better term because I would not be talking about the book per se, but as Katharina was saying, just some ideas to foster a bit the debate or the discussion with Jonathan. We have agreed with Jonathan and Katharina to keep it civil, but at the same time, this is a discussion. So while I believe there is a lot we agree on with Jonathan, I will try to focus on what we disagree on and explain why I believe this is the case, so that the audience can sort of form their minds up on their own during this discussion. Up front, I will say that I focus on climate change and greenhouse gases, and of course when if time allows or later in the discussion we can expand the focus to other planetary boundaries. But I think that the principles I'll be talking about are broadly applicable not only to climate change but to the wider environmental challenges we face. So first things first, given the title of today's seminar, my first keyword or my first point will revolve around economic growth. Now, here for a long time, I feel like there has been a debate on whether it was possible to carbonize growth or not. But from following the degrowth debate, and degrowth, preachers such as Jason Hickel or Matthias Schmelzer. My understanding is that also that type of literature worldview has moved to the conclusion that it is possible to decouple economic growth and CO2 emissions, but they would say this is not happening fast enough. Now, on this point, let me be clear, or as clear as I can be, which is I totally agree. So I'm not here, it is not my role, I'm not here, and it is not written in the book that everything is fine and that we can just sit back, relax, wait, and everything is going to be solved on its own. So on this, I agree that the pace of decarbonization is not fast enough, but that is also sort of where we depart as to what is needed next. To a, let's say, a degrowth worldview, this implies setting regulatory quantitative limits on emissions or banning the bad stuff, whether this is, you know, SUVs or beef or excessively large villas or cruise ships or private planes or intercontinental flight, you name it. And then it's a matter of persuading people to embrace all of this joyfully as voluntary scarcity. Now, to me, this is extremely unlikely to happen. And effectively, our disagreement revolves around the adjective voluntary. Because if this is not voluntary, it will simply be seen as scarcity. And scarcity is a synonym of poverty, albeit relative poverty. And there is no scenario where relative poverty will happen by policy design. Neither in a democracy, nor crucially in a green or eco-autocracy, because people will just oppose it. Which brings me to my second point, namely technology and innovation. Now, you can try and persuade people to consume differently and ditch certain things. For example, their big car, their intercontinental planes, their burgers and whatnot. And I'm all for that. So again, you know, the more we succeed in doing this, the better. I'm not saying that that's a bad thing. If you want to ditch some of these things, go for it. If you want to try and persuade your family and friends to ditch some of those things, go for it, and it's great. I just don't think that that by doing only that, we're going to go very far in the fight against climate change, especially given we have to reach net zero over the next 30 years, and basically everything emits CO2 at the moment in a fossil fuel civilization or in a civilization that has been built around fossil fuels. So what we need, in my view, is to replace the service that the polluting option provides or provided with an alternative. What people care about is the service that the polluting option provides, not the technology per se. So whether it is with a candle, whether it is burning whale fat, whether it is using a light bulb, or whether it is using an LED, this is of minor importance to a consumer, because what they care about is lighting their house, for example. Even though different technologies have big implications for the environment. The same is true for heating, the same is true for transport. So I believe that what we need to accelerate the rate of decarbonization is an acceleration in the development and deployment of new green technologies. And also on this, if we are looking for points of contact, I think that degrowth scholars partially agree, in the sense that, again, I've heard some of the scholars I was mentioning before say, you know, we need more green technology. But again, that's sort of where we depart, because to me, I empirically observe that the fastest acceleration in technological development has taken place for humanity as a whole, has taken place under capitalism. And so I believe that it is perhaps the best course of action would be to take measures in order to reorient this innovation machine towards our goal, namely decarbonization and the development and deployment of green technology. to degrowth scholars, it is better to do so in a planned way, so with government doing innovation. And here I stand unconvinced, especially for what concerns the fast deployment of this innovation, but perhaps Jonathan will persuade me otherwise. Note again that I'm not saying, and I underline this three times, I'm not saying that there is no role for government in decarbonization. For those of you that will choose to go through the book I have written, you will see that there is, and we will discuss it probably later, there is a role for government in all of this. I'm just saying that I don't think government will be the only engine of achieving green technology, and probably not even the main or the chief engine of this. And my third and final point is on the so-called agnostics. People like Kate Raworth, but also Jonathan, to my understanding, who are pragmatic in a way. And so, you know, what they say is, who cares about these philosophical debates? At the end of the day, you know, we have a target, which is reaching net zero, for example. So let's just get going with decarbonization. And if this creates growth, so be it. And if it doesn't, so be it. Who cares? And in a way, I have some sympathy with this view because it is practical and it has a can-do attitude, which is good and which is something I like in life in general. But I think it is based on a somewhat flawed understanding of long-term economic growth, what it is and what drives it. In my view, it is based on the persuasion that growth is simply a political obsession. You know, something driven by the fact that we measure GDP and we do so every year, or we do it every quarter, or we do it every month, in the case of the United Kingdom, for example. And so then we devote policy to increase it or rekindle it. But when you take a long-term historical perspective, which again is something I do and I devote a lot of space to in my book, you realize that, you know, growth didn't start when we started measuring GDP, not at all. Now, Jonathan, I suspect, but then we will see in a second, will try to persuade you that fast growth started shortly after capitalism was born, and therefore that it is capitalism that forces us to grow. But again, I think this is a false understanding, in the sense that fast growth started with capitalism, and that is what I was hinting to before, in the sense that capitalism paved the way for fast innovation and technology in addressing the needs of the time, which is just another way of saying economic growth. And that did not start with capitalism. Indeed, we know that there was growth before capitalism, just that it was awfully slow, as was technological development. And this is not because people did not crave it, but rather because they could not achieve it. In other words, insofar as there was ever a steady state, it was not by design and surely not out of voluntary scarcity. In my worldview, in the moment in which we use technology and innovation to deliver on something people care about, as is now the environment or the climate, this generates value and ultimately growth, albeit it being a different type of growth with respect to the one we've seen up until now, which is one based on, let's say, on fossil fuels. And this is why, to me, the fact that citizens care about the planet, care about the environment in large scores is so important. It is the founding step in order to get closer to the solution. So I suspect that if we were to follow the agnostic perspective and just get going on decarbonization, for example, we are actually going to get green growth, which is something I'm perfectly fine with, but I am happy to disagree and to listen to what Jonathan has to say.
Thanks a lot, Alessio. You smuggled in the green growth into another paradigm. And I liked your suggestion or your proposal to have this persuasion game going on. And so maybe for the audience, this is something that you can also, didn't ask you explicitly at the beginning, but if you want to place a question, we would also be curious to see sort of where you land on this debate and whether some of the arguments are sort of more convincing to you than the others. That's sort of, I've sneaked that in now, but before we come to the question and answers and the conversation, I give the floor to Jonathan. And you were addressed several times, but the nice thing about being the second is you can respond to only the things that you would like to pick up. And then we have a round between the three of us where I will ask some further questions, both to Alessio and to you. The floor is yours, Jonathan.
Thanks, Katarina. So if I'm speaking too fast, please remind me of that, because I was told that my microphone isn't working properly today. So also first, thanks to the whole team at Bertelsmann Foundation for hosting this event. It's quite a funny story behind that. It was a nice falling together of different pieces. So I was sitting together with Jason Hickel and Georgios Kallis earlier this year in Barcelona. And actually, Jason brought to their attention the book that Alessio has just written. And I was like, someone needs to talk with Alessio about his book. And then I was like, yeah, that's probably true. It would be nice to. And I already knew Alessio, I think, at that point. And then at some point, Alessio and I had also a quick exchange via email that at some point we need to have a discussion about that topic and about his book. And I was again agreeing. And then I think 2 days later, the email from Lucas came in and was like, don't you want to discuss together the book at the event of Bertelsmann Foundation? So really, really glad to be here. So and interesting to see how things sometimes align. So I also really enjoyed reading the book. And I first want to acknowledge Alessio for like finishing the book. I know that also like writing a book is it's not always easy. So congrats for that. And I also actually really like the way that you conveyed the message and that you really took the effort to like dive deep into the degrowth debates and really understand what are the issues at stake and what are the arguments brought forward rather than just like simply, confronting them with a different kind of position without really understanding what is the reasoning behind. I also have the impression that you're taking these issues very, very seriously. And so that's why I would first also start like, what do we align with? So I think we, as you said, we align with, okay, we are too slow. Decarbonization isn't happening fast enough. And you said that, well, everything that applies here also applies to other environmental topics. So we probably also agree on, okay, well, emissions are not the only problem if we think about biodiversity loss. Land use changes, the excessive use of resources and so forth is a much bigger or at least a problem of the same size. It has so far not gotten the same level of political attention, unfortunately. I think we also agree on that GDP growth in itself doesn't really tell you whether you are on track, but that you need to look at the respective indicators like how is wealth distributed, how fast are we in cutting emissions, and so forth. And we also agree, I guess, on like the state will be needed to also guide this transition to what extent I think is maybe open for discussion. But it's I think we have moved to a point where this idea of it's only prices that are going to fix the problem that was quite prominent in the last decades. I think that debate has now been complemented by this idea, okay, the state must also come in. So, and last point we agree on, I think the issues of social, decarbonization, the whole green transition is an issue that's very closely linked to the question of, social cohesion and tackling inequality, right? And also taking a polycentric approach to climate governance globally. So to like really look at the different nations and what they can do to decarbonize their economy rather than only thinking of the like silver bullet solution and the first best option that the global society, so to say, achieves this together. I think it's an either or thing, as you also write in your book. I think it's both, right? And I think that's also something that we. And last point, and then I'm stopping with the list of agreements, is that I think we also agree that economic growth makes it probably easier to deal with all these issues that are at stake, especially like reduce distributional conflicts, accelerate some of the innovations that you have talked about. But, and this is, I think, where now the discussion becomes maybe a bit interesting, I don't see that, I think we might disagree is about what are the consequences if we go through this whole transition, if we do all those policies that you have outlined, but also the policies that I think are very aligned with the policy program that we are developing at ZOE, what will be the consequence for economic growth? And I also don't think that economic growth is only a political obsession. I don't think so. Economic growth has been there, and it will be there, whether you measure it or whether you don't measure it. I think that's not the point. But this is also why it's so tremendously difficult to just like say we imagine an economy where economic growth, as long as you measure it, isn't happening. Because we don't know how that would work, right? Because right now, our economies, and this is the point that we usually bring forward, are structurally dependent, like the stability of these economies, fighting inequality, having sustainable public finances, all of that, also social security systems, right? All of that is strongly dependent on continuous rates of growing GDP. And this dependence wouldn't be a problem if we just say, yeah, we will continue growing in the future. Because then, you can have all these things all together. And I agree, if that would be the case, then the life would be easier. But I think I'm a bit more skeptical on if we implement these policies, if we set limits to carbon emissions, to resource use, how this will ultimately affect the rates of economic growth. And I don't say I know what the future will be. It might be that green growth works, right? And that accelerating all these technologies, like the development, but also the deployment of these technologies comes with a high rate of economic growth. But I'm also, I think it's naive to think that this will for sure be the case. And this is for me the definition of being agnostic. It's not only about saying I don't care about economic growth. It's also about preparing for these potential different futures. So what do we do if economic growth would decline as a consequence of the policy program that you are imagining? And in that case, I wouldn't just say, yeah, let's just not think about that, because in that case, the world will break apart anyways, and we will have all those distributional conflicts, and this is then how it's going to be. But, and I think this is also the effort from the whole post-growth movement to trying to provide ideas and solutions how a world could look like in this extreme scenario, because there might be a realistic, it might actually be a realistic scenario to some extent. And so, I mean, we could, and I hope we will do that. We will debate this a bit more now in the coming minutes. I think the one other point I would just want to make is, why do I think that economic growth might also decline as a consequence of that program? And there are basically two trends that I think everyone who is looking at this issue has to look at. One is the green economy that's phased in at certain prices, and the dirty economy that's phased out. So both of these dynamics have a supply side and a demand side. Supply side in the sense of, okay, we produce new technologies, for example, heat pumps, hydrogen solutions, technological solutions, and so forth, right? Demand side, okay, we have a demand for certain products, made plant-based food products, made e-vehicles, and so forth, right? And the question if there's economic growth or not is only relevant on the aggregate. So if these two trends overlap, like, and the the speed of like phasing out the dirty industry is maybe even a bit slower than phasing in the green industry, then you might say, yeah, well, you will just like still have on the aggregate economic growth. But if we look at the speed at which certain technologies and behaviors have to be phased out during this transition, I'm very skeptical that if adding up these two dynamics will at the end lead to economic growth. I can go more in detail later. It's also a bit of a complex and nerdy discussion, but let's see what we get. And I stop here as a first fruits for thought. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, Jonathan. I think as you both addressed each other, and everybody can watch you debate, I think you have points to reply, and I'll just throw in some more not sticks into the wheels, but some sort of, I want to highlight some of the aspects that you've said, and then we'll take another round on this virtual panel before we open up the discussion to the audience. But I can already invite the audience to start thinking about questions and also start writing them into the chat if you like. And I would start with Alessio. And one thing, and I think Jonathan you both mentioned the question of decoupling and decoupling growth from emissions or from environmental degradation. And the question to me would really be probably also an empirical question: how much decoupling is possible, and how much is needed in order to have this the growth paradigm still hold in a net zero economy? Is there any ways we can live with some residual degradation or emission in your framework? So it's pretty difficult to answer empirically, but how much of your ideas depend on the fact that we will be able to decouple all of it or most of it from emission and environmental degradation? And the second question goes to Jonathan. You've mentioned it already. I'm a little bit overemphasizing now, but Alessio has really put an effort or an emphasis on the supply side, particularly on the question of technology and innovation that will drive decarbonization or this green future. He's also talked about the demand side, but the faith is in the innovation and the fast innovation and technology side. Where would you place your hopes and where are your channels and mechanisms to arrive at a fast green economy or a fast net zero economy? And the second question to you is, and we can also take that into the discussion later on, is you basically say we shouldn't put all our eggs into this one growth basket, and we have to somehow have to imagine these alternative futures where we don't have growth and we still want to achieve our goals. And maybe you can say a little bit about these alternative non-growth, if you want, futures, the positive ones. Because the negative ones, Alessio has mentioned very briefly, but is also a part of his book, that this brings distributional problems and potentially also political strife with it. So these would be my two questions for you, but take what you want to pick up from the other, and we'll go into the order as before, and then we'll open it up to the audience, and maybe you let us know whether you've been persuaded one way or the other.
So just I'll pick up on a few things. Well, let me thank, first of all, Jonathan for his kind words towards an author. It is indeed, it took a lot of my time indeed to write this book. So thanks a lot for acknowledging that and your kind words and for reading it, most importantly. So there are a few, some of the points you raised. Allow me to clarify my position on a few points. The first you pulled out this frequently mentioned concept of limits, and so how will growth respond in the moment in which we set limits to CO2 or we set limits to material use. And here again we get philosophical very fast, and I state again that I'm sorry for this, because I appreciate and salute your efforts to keeping it practical, tangible, and hands-on, but in a way it gets a bit abstract, in the sense that it sort of pushes us to understand what economic growth is and where it originates from. And my feeling is that to those that for a long time, and to those that have this view that, you know, in the moment in which I place limits on CO2, this will sap growth, all of this is based on a concept of value creation that is associated with the extraction of stuff, of raw materials, and that, you know, growth is the product of the extraction and burning of oil, or burning of coal, or the destruction of, or the extraction of gold or copper or whatever it is, which you know is not the way that I would look at these issues, and it's not the way that most of the mainstream, let's say, growth economics literature looks at these things, and rather. I would see economic growth as I was mentioning already in my introductory remarks, as innovation per se. And so it is not tied to the destruction of nature or to the use of a specific raw material, or to destroying climate, or burning out greenhouse gases. And the way you know this is that we've seen this, you know, climate change to the scale and extent that we're seeing it now is an unprecedented phenomenon in human history, but it belongs to a wider category of problems with the environment, with limits, with access to raw materials, which is something we have seen throughout human history, albeit on a smaller scale. And all the times that we were, as humanity, as specific civilizations, reaching these limits on one specific front, we know what happened, which is you substitute away from whatever it is. And so you substitute away from, in our case, fossil fuels, or you substitute away from extraction of raw materials and more towards recycling, or the use of inorganic and building your technologies out of inorganic materials and perhaps use more, you know, plant-based solutions or whatnot. And to a certain extent, you know, here I don't want to speculate too much, because I'm not a futurist. I'm not Jeremy Rifkin. I'm here to understand the process of innovation, not to tell you like, you've got to bet everything on this or that technology, because I think that in a way I'm more interested in how innovation comes about in our system. Regarding the point that also Katarina sort of raised with you of not putting all your eggs in one basket, again, I sympathize with the concept. It is a basic, let's say, insurance principle. It applies to finance as well. You don't only bet on one thing, which is fine. And it's fine also what you were saying, you know, we're not looking for the silver bullet to climate. So it will be a matter of investing on a lot of things, different energy sources, different technologies. And they will all play their part, and the sum of our efforts will lead to winning this challenge. So I completely agree with the overall point. Perhaps where I disagree is that, to me, giving up growth is in a completely different ballpark game. And because I think that that growth is something that is closer to an innate human characteristic rather than, you know, something that comes out of the policy process because we've been rekindling it actively, the policies that would be needed in order to manage a post-growth world or to bring growth to a halt, or those that would, in a way, destroy the economic system we have, which is also what makes me wonder how you can have these friendly conversations at the dinner table with Georgios Kallis and Jason Hickel, because they would agree with me. As in, they see exactly growth the way I see it. The only point where we disagree is that they think that's exactly the point. And so that you have exactly to tear down the whole economic system, because if not, it will just continue delivering growth. And so they would agree with me in the fact that it's not a matter of adding an extra egg in the basket of the solutions to climate change, but rather it is a completely different thing that would require adding an extra solution, but rather throwing the basket out of the window type of solution. And I will stop there to give you time to reply.
Throwing the basket out of the window. Jonathan.
Yeah, I don't think I want to throw out the basket out of the window. But I'm not sure if I would follow fully your, like, let's start with the innovation point, okay? But so I think what you point at is, of course, if you look at economic growth, and also just being like nice to the audience, I will just quickly explain that. So you have like different kinds of components that come together when we try to look at growth and see what is adding up. Adds up to that figure. So one is, well, you have like maybe higher inputs of labor. So we work more, that generates growth because you might produce more because you work more. You have like capital, so in the sense of production capacities that can produce more. And then if you add these two up, you will figure out, and this I think was, well, the sort of model at some point, you understand there's a lot residual, big residual that you cannot explain. I think what you're pointing at, Alessio, is, okay, well, this residual is then innovation, it's technological change. And that's true. I also think that's true. But I think your conclusion that this residual doesn't have to do anything with resource extraction, that's flawed. Because if you look at what this innovation is about, and this is also where some of the more like modeling experienced degrowthers what they have shown is that a lot of that is basically substituting labor with energy and resources, getting rid of very labor-intensive tasks. So this kind of innovation is, of course, also other things. It's also, of course, like product innovation, and certain things get cheaper, and this is why we have like more and more and more things that we are actually able to consume. But still, like if you talk about productivity growth, then this is a lot driven by replacing labor with energy. So we'll always need and rely on more energy input and more resource input to come up with these tasks. You can now probably reply, yeah, but the service economy is not that. I'm already taking your reply to that, or assuming you would reply like that. I would say, well, also the service economy is hugely reliant on a lot of like material inputs. If you are like, I don't know, if you want to have like a concert, then you need a room for the concert, you need a guitar, you need like a lot of chairs, you need a lot of drinks, all of that needs to be produced at some point. So this is for me not interested. And then I think the other kind of innovation that you talk about is the innovation that is not replacing labor, but it's actually replacing one resource by another resource, right? So this is why you say, okay, well, when we set limits, then we will have like this dynamic of things get more expensive and they will be replaced by like another good. So if like the assumption would be, if we are facing limits for copper, for example, which I think is reasonable to assume that we are already facing some limits when it comes to copper production to meet the needs for the energy transition, then this will generate so much pressure on the economic system that we will basically substitute copper. And I also think that's true to it. Like, well, of course, this is what is happening, right? But the assumption to, like, if you link this to sustainability, then your assumption would be that this substitution is happening fast enough to keep pace with the decarbonization need that the speed of carbonization that we need. And this is where I think I'm more skeptical, because the timeframes you're talking about are not 50 years. The timeframe we are talking about is like more 20 years. And if I think of like one material input like copper, that is like so important for so many different pieces of electrifying our whole economy, then I'm a bit more skeptical that we will actually, within that time, substitute it and or find alternative copper mines that are just able to give us all the copper that we need. I'm just taking one random example, right? You can like also just translate that to any other kind of scarce material that we have. And so I don't want to like throw the baby out of the bathwater and say, yeah, let's get rid of the market mechanism and say, we just like scale down the economy by order, right? I'm just, what I'm saying is, if we set those limits, what might happen, especially if you set limits also on resources and on land use, for example, which we are not talking about right now in the whole discussion. If we do that, then the only way to stay within these limits, because we are substituting not at sufficient speed, might be at some point to cut down production. And maybe that's not something you brought in, like the state is doing that, right? And you brought in the question of if it's voluntary or not. I'm done in a minute, Katharina. I think this doesn't even have to happen by the state. The prices will then just, if you take this limit serious, the prices will just be so high that people will just not afford those goods anymore. And the problem is that this mechanism that's then happening is just exactly the same as when you are entering a recession. And then you have exactly the same like problems. And this is what then the whole post-growth debate is about, preparing for a scenario where you are not then sacrificing the limits, because this would be the easy out, but actually saying, yeah, okay, let's talk about how can we keep up high levels of well-being and lower resource use. And now I could come in with proper solutions to that, because Katharina, you asked me for that, but I don't know if I should stop maybe for a minute and you come in for 1 second.
We can pack this question, because there are some questions coming into the Q&A, and I think there's one question that this might link very well to. And we can talk about this sort of together. I like the fact that you've sort of already in each other's heads, knowing what the arguments might be, is already sort of preemptively giving an answer. But we bring in some other heads now, and there might be some clarifications needed. Maybe you can just repeat it. And then there's a third question. There's three questions right now. And that, I think, gets us to another issue and the question also of the politics of it. So one, maybe you can just clarify this again. I think this question is probably addressed to you, Jonathan. Is the question whether a member of the audience asked whether he got it right, that both of you think growth in the future must happen? Is there no stopping or enough of growth? And I think, Jonathan, you would, or you might both disagree. So there's sort of a need for clarification whether growth is needed. And you can sort of just sort of quickly maybe repeat this or sort of clarify this. And then there's another question, and that's sort of going back to Alessio. And this is the question, the idea that every technological solutions requires some kind of resources and threatens some kind of planetary boundaries. And you mentioned it at the beginning, but we talked mainly about emissions. Now we've talked about a little bit about resource scarcity and the question of land, but there's also the issue of biodiversity. So it's sort of broader. And the question really is, we're sort of touching many planetary boundaries with technological innovations or technological solutions. And the question really is, the question is whether growth then has to be sort of non-material innovation and what that would mean. And you talked a little bit about this, Alessio, in the question of substitution, but maybe you can sort of bring some clarifications or putting it in different words again, because this is, after all, a sort of very difficult, big concepts that we're discussing here. And the third question, and that leads us, Jonathan, also to this question of sort of alternative scenarios. It's a question that asks how much growth will be needed to provide governments with sufficient means to prevent societies from abandoning democracy. So this is sort of bringing us into the question of social cohesion and sort of how to ensure that we are sort of not having this as our brain children, but also sort of finding majorities and finding some sort of consensus and support, political support for some of these measures. So the question really is, how is that linked to, how can we sort of link this to democracy? And if a society becomes autocratic and sort of zero emissions will no longer be an important objective of an autocratic government, sort of losing touch with the goals that we initially set out that we want to achieve. So the question really is how do you, what are the politics behind it? And I sort of bring in my other question again, and I know it's a lot to answer now, but we're also sort of running out of time. What are sort of the main features of a political system or the role of the state, as Alessio has mentioned, that are needed? So that would also be sort of bringing in another system, apart from the economic system, bringing in the political system. And so maybe you can sort of elaborate on this in the final round. We have another 10 minutes. If there are more questions coming in, I'll try to bring in maybe a final round, but we'll take it from here. And maybe we start with Jonathan, because you didn't get a chance to talk about the politics or the alternative scenarios that we might have to prepare for also politically.
Thanks. That's a lot of questions for 5 minutes. So just to be really clear, because it was asked if growth is like, if there must be growth, or I don't know exactly what the question was, but this is not what I'm concerned about. And the question is, will there be growth? That's the question. And then is there any way that we can, well, manage our society without growth? And there might be growth, but there might also not be growth. So this is like, I'm uncertain about the future because I don't know the future. And this is, yeah, why I think we need to talk about these two scenarios. And the problem is, and this is where the must comes in, at the moment, political and social stability require us to grow. But this is a problem because if this growth is at the end leading to an overshoot on planetary boundaries, which it is right now, then we are just faced with this dilemma, either sacrifice social and political stability or sacrifice our planetary boundaries, which in the end will also, by the way, lead to probably lower political and social stability. And I'm looking for a solution how to escape that dilemma. And I hope that clarifies the question. Then on the other question, I think that's a bit linked to this, is growth needed to make sure that we do not abandon democracy? So I think this speaks to also an important point that Alessio made, that economic growth is making it a lot easier to deal with redistributional conflicts in democracies. And once there's like, well, there's a, you call it, I think, the zero-sum game, right? And there's just a certain pool of resources that can just be redistributed between people, then the fights around that cake are becoming more dense. And I think that's a true observation. But what I want to add is, it's not like we don't have these fights right now yet, right? We already have them. If you read the work of Piketty, what he is already projecting is, okay, actually we are to a certain extent already entering into a phase where certain income groups have much more higher influence on shaping public policy. And the question of, is it really still like a democracy? Of course, by law, we are still in democracy, but there is that already very like different influence on the level of policy from different income groups. And certain, like especially lower income groups are much less represented in the policy choices that we are making. And this is exactly the kind of question that also then is debated by the post-growth people to ask, okay, how can we make sure that the broader society benefits from the cake that is there, right? And it's not like, at the moment, we are basically funding a huge, like a small group of people that is having a very, very high levels of wealth. And we are kind of basically financing that, right? And if we, of course, have like a limited cake and it's not growing anymore, then we have to ask the question, do we still want to finance that that big piece of cake? And what are the policies then to really sweep this? And then this is, I think, where it comes then to the political side of things. And one, of course, is like a redistribution program. So we could think of inheritance taxes. You can think of wealth taxes. Also, I think other interesting proposals go into like land taxation. So any kind of taxes that are especially hitting the people that are right now excessively benefiting from economic growth and kind of rebalancing who is actually benefiting from economic activities. So this I think is from a social point of view, the program that needs to happen. And then on an environmental point of view, just to also to add to that, and I think it also links to the question of non-material innovation. The innovation, I think, from post-growth kind of point of view, would like to be seen is one where we share more goods, where we are not owning the goods anymore, where we try to like also behave in ways that are then less reliant on material consumption. So if I'm driving a bicycle, then I have a much lower footprint than if I'm driving a car. If I'm like just, sharing some of the appliances that I'm just needing once a year with other people, then I'm having a less material footprint. And I think these kinds of innovation will automatically also come in when we increase the prices for energy consumption, when we increase the prices for resource use. And this is, I think, the kinds of innovation that we would imagine. But the discussion could go for hours. I could come up with like a lot of other policy proposals as well, just picking out like two and directing the audience to all the books that have been written about that.
Thank you very much. And maybe also focusing on some that Alessio might not put into his focus if he sort of thinks about the policy agenda. We will see. Alessio.
No, thanks. Thanks also to the audience for the questions. In a way, I think I can connect it to something that Jonathan was saying as well, which is, yeah, you know, we're substituting, and we've done it in the past, we substitute one technology for another, or one resource for another, and then we come up with a problem later on. Yes, and that's exactly how humanity has been moving throughout the challenges that we have. As in, my impression is that we are looking for the ultimate solution to all the problems, all possible future problems that we may have, which is not going to happen. It's setting the bar extremely high. Whereas I agree that there are certain planetary boundaries that we've breached through, and that we are going to use technology, know-how, different ways of doing things in order to address these issues and alleviate the pressure on nature, on these dimensions. Will this generate other problems? Yes, maybe yes. Actually, surely yes. And then as we move on, we will try to address that problem as well. And that's how the whole of the history of humanity has evolved. And in a way, it is the very concept of progress itself. And so the concept of progress is this idea that humanity takes its destiny in its own hands and uses what we have, which at the end of the day is this capacity for collective learning, teaching, development of new technologies and ideas, which is the only asset we really have, because if not, we're a mid-sized mammal without particularly good features on this planet. And as we do that, so as we try to re-enter, to reduce the concentration of nitrogen in the water, or as we try to improve or reduce biodiversity collapse, we will be doing it by taking active steps. And those active steps are active steps that will generate value. And that value, if you want, you can call it economic growth. If you don't want to call it economic growth, you just call it value, a different type of value. So the value will not be having the biggest car in the neighborhood, but it will be having the greenest of neighborhoods or the largest park reservoirs or the largest marine reservoirs or whatnot. So that is one point. On the point of Jonathan's post-growth view of the world, I think, yes, you know, of course, there are these institutions that have been designed, be it the pension system relies on further growth, or it can be, you know, Wolfgang Strick, I think, a sociologist, spoke about the ticking time bomb that is associated with these programs that we've put in place, or it can be public debt and whatnot. And yes, of course, these were our institutions or financial markets and so on that we've designed in times of high growth. And so to a certain extent, yes, they have built-in features for that. But I don't think, like, I really try to abstract further from it. And I really try to understand, you know, the role of growth and how it links to having resources available, not natural resources, but being capable of doing things. And I don't think that it is possible to manage without, in the sense of without this expectation that we have of trying to solve problems and be better, be doing better as a society. And so that imperative is not going to go away, and that you're not going to manage anything in the sense that you're not going to manage a steady state, but rather in the pursuit of a steady state or stabilizing a steady state, it is more likely to see a collapse rather than, which again is something we've seen throughout history. There's all the work of Jared Diamond, who wrote a book whose title is Collapse. And I think it is more likely that you see that type of thing rather than tweaking institutions here and there and the pension system and the public debt financial markets, and that in that way you stabilize. And the final point on Piketty, and I'm saying, you know, we're already seeing these tensions in society. I think it's a very bad example in the sense that Piketty's work and the R minus G and R being larger than G is exactly, and it is Piketty who says, is exactly because G has been slowing down. And so Piketty is a very bad example for you, for Giorgio Scalis, for Jason Hickel, for Mattias and so on, and all the crew of friends, because what he's saying is precisely because economic growth has been slowing down over the past few decades in advanced economies, that's exactly why we see these clashes within society exacerbating. And all I'm saying is we're going to see more and more of that if we were to enter into some type of a steady state economy.
Thank you. I know it's very difficult to end this because whoever ends has sort of the last word. And so I think the easiest is if I have the last word, because otherwise I know that we could go and take several rounds on some of the issues. And there are also some more questions relating to the question of climate adaptation and migration, which is also related to politics, but sort of not within the nation state, but sort of more globally. And there have been questions, has been another question on how in a non-growth world, we'll still need technological change, because after all, we've emitted already quite a lot and we're still sort of fighting climate change, irrespective of where we grow to. And so on. The question is, how do we get the technological change? I will have to leave these questions for another debate because we are already at 5 o'clock. But what I want to do is to thank you sincerely. And I think I can thank you also in the name of the audience, because what you both have done is to sort of engage in a very passionate, but also in a very open way about different arguments on all kinds of levels. And that's very difficult to do in an hour on the sort of the question, what is growth? Are we actually talking about the right thing here? Or are we talking about the same thing? On empirical questions is how does progress come about? How does change come about? how has change come about in the past? And I also asked you to sort of go into the practical and political dimensions of sort of how do we go from here and sort of what can the state do? What should the state do? That is a lot to ask in 60 minutes. So this can only be the beginning of a discussion. And I hope that both of you, but also the audience will join us again in one way or another. We will continue with these discussions in all kinds of fora and places. And I hope that for the audience, you got some ideas clarified, or maybe there is some sort of confusion on a higher level now, as we will continue to grapple with the different questions and the different answers in this debate. And so thank you very much. There is the possibility, we have recorded the event, to rewatch it, and maybe sort of some things went very fast and you want to sort of listen to them again. I'm pretty sure that you will be able to find all the members of this panel online to address some further questions if you do have them. And otherwise, I hope you join us again for another virtual seminar in the not too long future. Thank you very much, Jonathan and Alessio.
Thank you.
Thank you, Katharina. Thanks, Alessio. Thank everyone for being here. Bye.